Brett McKay here, and welcome to another edition of the Art of Manliness podcast. Now, a few months ago, I wrote an in-depth series on the anthropology, the history, the philosophy, the biology of the culture of manhood that we find across the globe and across time. Yes, there are differences between culture to culture, small ones, but they all have these high-level general principles in common on what it means to be a man and what manhood means. And one of those high-level principles is that a man is supposed to be a protector. And that means using violence and aggression to protect his family, his tribe, and also to invade other countries to get more resources. It means being competitive. It means having martial courage. That's what it means to be a man. And we make the case that's sort of the core of masculinity on what it means to be a man across cultures. But why is this? Why is it that men are called upon to fulfill this role as protector and are expected to be aggressive and competitive and sometimes willing to do violence if necessary? Some would say that it's just a completely cultural construct, and that if you change the culture, you can change the way men behave. But our guest today has an argument that there is a biological component to why men tend to be more violent, more aggressive, more competitive. His name is Dr. Richard Wrangham. He's a professor of biological anthropology at Harvard University, and he's the co-author of the book, Demonic Males, Apes and the Origins of Human Violence. And in his book, he highlights research that's been done in recent years among primates, specifically the great apes and specifically the chimpanzees, on male violence. And what he's found is that there's a lot of similarities specifically between male chimps and male humans on how we approach violence and how they form male bonded groups. Male chimps also are very violent, and we'll talk about how they actually engage in warfare in a way, just as male humans do. Male chimps tend to form male bonded groups, like little armies, basically little gangs, just like male humans tend to do. So it's just a fascinating discussion. And we only scratched the surface in this conversation, so I recommend you go pick up the book after you listen to this podcast to delve deeper into this. So without further ado, let's get on to the show with Dr. Richard Wrangham. Dr. Wrangham, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much. Nice to be here.
Well, before we get to talking about your book, Demonic Males, let's talk a bit about your profession, because I think this is interesting. I never heard of this before until I read your book. You're a professor of biological anthropology. Can you explain what biological anthropology is?
Let me first explain what anthropology is. And that is, of course, just the study of people from many different perspectives, but particularly understanding different cultures. And then biological anthropology is the biological component of that. And to some extent, it looks at differences among cultures, but actually the great majority of its attention is given to thinking about us as a species in comparison to other species. So asking questions about why is it that we have different kinds of bodies, different kinds of physiology, different kinds of behavior, in my case, from other species.
Interesting. And you specifically focus on chimps, right, or primates?
Well, I started studying chimpanzees in the 1970s, and when I did that, I was not an anthropologist. I was just an ordinary biologist thinking about the evolution of animal behavior. But there's something so striking when you study chimpanzees, and after about 20 minutes of seeing them close up in the wild and just seeing the way they use their eyes and their facial expressions and their gestures, you realize that there's something about chimpanzees that is sort of half human, half animal, to put it at its crudest. You know, they have a lot of complexity in the way that their behavior and their mental processes are organized. And so that draws you, as a biologist studying chimpanzees, into the study of anthropology.
Okay. So your book is called Demonic Males. This was written back in 1996, and it's about apes and the origins of human violence. And until fairly recently, scientists thought that human beings were the only species of animal that deliberately killed members of their own species in acts of warfare or murder. And they often blamed our ability to reason or civilization for our violent tendencies. But that changed because of an event that happened in the 1970s, where primatologists observed an incident amongst a pack of chimps. that had forced them to reevaluate humanity's monopoly on premeditated killing and war. Can you describe that event?
Yes. No, you're absolutely right about the setup. Even in the late 1960s, there was a very famous book called On Aggression by the great biologist Conrad Lorenz, and he said humans are unique. We don't kill. We kill each other. Other animals don't. The thing is that people hadn't watched animals much at that point. And there we were in 1974 with chimpanzees in the wild, already realizing that there was something pretty intense going on about their relationships, because we were working with two groups of chimps which had been one about 5 years before, but they'd become increasingly separate. And in January 1974, a small group of chimpanzees from one of those communities moved towards the territorial border and went into the area that's normally occupied by the neighboring group. And they found one individual in the neighboring group who they stalked, like as if they were prey, as if it was lions stalking an antelope, and got sufficiently close that the victim was unable to escape. He was chased down, and they grabbed him and pummeled him really hard. He didn't die on the spot. He was able to drag himself away, but he died a couple of days later. And that was the first case that any of the chimp people saw in which you had really deliberate hunting and killing of a member of their own species, another adult of their own species. Very dramatic.
Yeah, the way you described it, it just seemed really brutal because chimps are... They're very strong, and they're like three or four times stronger than human beings or something like that.
Yes, I mean, one of the amazing things, as we've now accumulated much more information since in the last 20 years, is that you can take something like 100 kills that have been seen with real confidence in the wild, and in not a single case have any of the attackers been hurt. Well, that's amazing, considering that you've got an animal three or four times as strong as a human, fighting for its life, absolutely desperate, but it can't put any wounds on the aggressors. And why is that? Because they always choose, when attacking, to attack in sufficient number that they're safe. So basically, if four of them each take one limb and hold it down, then the fifth can do whatever they like. They can drum on the rib cage of the victim, and nothing's going to happen. And in fact, what they do is they tear out the thorax, and they tear off the testicles, and they pull skin back by gripping it with their teeth to pull it away from the body. Awful wounds all over the place. I mean, it's terrible stuff. And yet they don't get hurt because they've immobilized the victim. And that's because they're smart enough to organize a group of four or five or eight or 10 or 12 or whatever it is to isolate one victim and then do their worst.
Okay. But why do chimps do this? Because in most species, animals just defend territory. But what you're describing here and what primatologists have observed countless more times since then is that these chimps are actually organizing and going into other communities and basically raiding them. What is the evolutionary purpose? I mean, what do they stand to gain from that?
It seems pretty clear what's going on. What they stand to gain is territory. It's more land. It's not that they take over the neighboring group. It's just that if they attack members of neighboring groups and kill them, then it's more likely that they will be able to use that area in the future, that it will be poorly defended by the neighboring group. So they just increase slightly the area that they use. And why is that important? It's because the bigger the area, then we know this very clearly, the more food they get, and the more food they get, then the faster they're able to reproduce and the better they're able to survive, because energy coming from food is always limiting, and the more you can get, then the better you can survive and reproduce.
Fascinating. So are chimps the only primate that does this besides human beings? I mean, do orangutans or gorillas do this sort of raiding?
None of the other close relatives of humans do, but it does look as though there is some very similar behavior in actually a monkey that lives in the Americas from Mexico to Peru, the spider monkey, because they have a rather similar pattern to chimpanzees of, instead of living in a stable troop, they break up into small units, like chimpanzees do. And it's because of this breaking up, a constant fission and fusion of the parties that leaves sometimes a big group and sometimes an isolated individual, that you can get these great asymmetries with one group being able to isolate a lone individual. So that seems to be the key. It's not so much that chimps are closely related to us. It's more that they have the same kind of grouping pattern.
Interesting. So you talk about the chimps organize themselves in these little patrols, five or eight chimpanzees. Are these strictly male groups, or are there females involved?
No, this is very, very much male. There are occasions when females might join. And the classic example is there was one particular female called Gigi, who is now long dead. But when she was alive in Gombe in Tanzania, she did sometimes join the males. Now, the funny thing about Gigi is she never had a baby. She was apparently sterilized early in life, or maybe genetically sterile for some reason. And at any rate, she was rather male-like. She was rather broad-shouldered and big. And she did sometimes go on the patrols. But even then, she did not join in. She would watch the males doing all the terrible beating and attacking, and she would run around excitedly. So that showed that even when a female was there, it's a male activity. And normally, it is only males. And in fact, the parties, the subgroups that you find within the center of the community range of chimpanzees, they are very much mixed, say 50-50, male and female. But as they move towards the edge, you find the females dropping off. And then by the time they get to the right of the edge of the territory, it's pretty much 100% males.
Fascinating. What similarities have you found between the way chimps engage in warfare, from what we can call it that, and how they bond in group, and what we see in humans?
Well, the things that are found in chimps are very much similar to what you find in humans, but humans make it more complicated, of course. But the elements of a group of males taking the opportunity to attack helpless victims, and not just attack them, but kill them. That is something that you see in small-scale societies of humans. And indeed, you can say that you see it in modern warfare. You know, the aim of a modern warfare, the aim of a good commander, is to send his men on an attack that will leave them all safe and will just kill members of the enemy. In other words, you're always trying to arrange for asymmetries of power to your maximum advantage. What humans do that is more complicated is several things, and I'll draw attention to two of them. One is that humans take more risks. So if you look at the literature on warrior behavior in small-scale societies such as hunters and gatherers, what you find is that, unlike chimpanzees, the aggressors do sometimes get hurt. There's an ambush of the aggressors, or there's a very quick defense mounted by the defenders. They grab a weapon or whatever. And this reflects the fact that some kind of benefit is needed to compensate the warriors for this. And the benefits are clear. They're cultural. In the societies of humans, you have various kinds of rewards that everyone knows about, that you will get higher status, that you will get more wives, you'll get access to some of the resources that are at stake. So humans are able to inculcate a militarization of a basic biological tendency. And then the second thing, of course, is that chimps are doing this from just one particular community of up to 200 individuals who all live and share the same area. But of course, what humans can do is to organize coalitions to be between neighboring villages or neighboring groups, and then that tremendously enlarges the whole operation.
Interesting. One of the things that this book did for me is it kind of shattered that myth that a lot of people have about, you know, civilized cultures being the only type of culture that engage in warfare, and that primitive hunter-gatherer societies live in peace and harmony. But the research shows that warfare is actually very ubiquitous, or was very ubiquitous, amongst hunter-gatherer societies. Can you describe some of the research that shows, you know, how likely someone was to get killed in a hunter-gatherer society, or how likely they were to actually kill another person? There's this idea, I guess, that the noble savage is the myth that people have. And where did that myth come from? And why do we have that?
Historically, you can talk about it being the musings of Jean-Jacques Rousseau, the 18th, 19th century French intellectual who was just very impressed by a few primitive or a few sort of small-scale peoples that he came across. But as with many of these people, they had already been affected by modern life. And the basic answer to your question about why is it that we tend to think that people living as hunters and gatherers are so peaceful is that they've very rarely been studied except where they're living next to militarily powerful farmers, and they're smart enough to know they're not going to do well fighting against the farmers. And then if you look further, you find there's evidence that the farmers had in the past defeated them, essentially. The critical question is, what happens when you look at hunters and gatherers that have been neighbored by other hunters and gatherers who speak a different language? And there are something like 6 culture areas around the world where you can find such cases. And there you find awful violence. So as long as you look in the right areas where you don't have the hunters and gatherers already having been dominated by a much more powerful group, then you find this sort of somewhat chimpanzee-like behavior.
Hmm. So, I mean, the question is, you're a biological anthropologist. And so there must be a reason why chimps and humans, human males specifically, have this violent temperament. I mean, why was it that the males in both these species developed a violent temperament? You know, what purpose did it serve?
Well, in a tragic way, it seems to benefit both the males and the females. If you think about the community of chimpanzees, they are always going to be surrounded by other groups of chimpanzees. And the only way they can get more access to the food that is so important for ultimately producing more babies and having evolutionary success is to expand at the expense of the neighbors. And it so happens that in chimpanzees, the ecology that they have evolved with is one in which it pays to live in groups that sometimes you travel alone and sometimes you travel in a bigger group, which gives rise to the asymmetry. Okay, so now males and females are both interested in getting a larger group, a larger area is what I'm trying to say, where they can get more resources. And this will be true of any species, but only in chimpanzees, or very rarely elsewhere, do you have the regular asymmetry that enable killing to be favored. And why is it just the males? Well, the mothers are burdened by their young, and it's very dangerous for them to get involved in the attacks. And over evolutionary time, natural selection has favored mothers who are relatively fearful of going to the edge and getting involved in these fights, whereas it's favored males who relish the idea, who get very excited by the prospect of going off and beating up the neighbors. And the net result is that their group does well, and as a consequence, they do well as well. They are able to increase the number of babies they pass on to future generations.
Hmm. Human beings are not only related to chimpanzees. In recent, particularly in the media, they've talked a lot about the bonobos, or bonobos, I don't know how you pronounce it, as sort of this docile or peaceful, you know, close relative of ours. The chimps and the bonobos have a different culture, where the chimps are more aggressive and the bonobos more peaceful. Can you describe a little bit more detail the difference between chimps and bonobos and why these differences emerge between the two?
Yeah, it is a totally fascinating story, and we still don't understand all of it. You said there's a different culture between them, and in a sense that's right, but if we're going to be strictly accurate, it's a different biology, it's a different psychology. You know, you put chimpanzees and bonobos into zoos in identical conditions, and there's a complete difference in the way they behave. Now, this is very, very striking because bonobos are very like chimpanzees to look at. In fact, they're so similar that Western scientists had seen bonobos for some time, several years, before they realized that they are a different species. And it's the behavior that shows it. And what is it about the behavior? It's a number of things, but more striking than anything, the bonobos are, as you said, relatively peaceful. It doesn't matter whether you're talking about captive or wild, males or females, whether they've been fed by humans or they're in nature, whether you're talking about within-group aggression or between-group aggression. In all these ways, chimpanzees are far more aggressive than the bonobos. So that's the fact. There are other things linked to this. There's more non-conceptive sexuality among the bonobos. They're famously homosexual. They're famously diverse in their sexual practices. But the important thing, from a biological perspective, the most important thing seems to be the reduced aggression. And now, where does this come from? Well, the one thing I think we can say about this with some confidence is that bonobos have evolved from a chimpanzee-like ancestor rather than the other way around. And the reason you can say that is because of a fascinating similarity between bonobos and dogs. So this is a little bit surprising that I suddenly introduced a totally different species. But here's the formula. Wolf is to dog as chimpanzee is to bonobo. In other words, dogs have evolved from wolves by reducing aggression. They've become domesticated. And bonobos have evolved from something like chimpanzees by reducing aggression. And the reason we can say this is because just as you find in all domesticated animals, there are certain features that change in the skull. The skull becomes relatively small in dogs compared to wolves. The teeth become smaller, the face becomes shorter, and the brain becomes smaller. Well, all of these things happen in bonobos compared to chimps. It's a fascinating story of a parallel in the wild to what we see in domesticated animals. And the parallels mean that there was natural selection against aggressiveness in bonobos, and they ended up being this nicer, kinder species. They're still somewhat aggressive, but just enormously less so than chimps. This probably has started happening just a little less than a million years ago, long after the chimpanzee bonobo line had split off from humans about 6 million years ago. And why it happened, it's a fascinating question, and I think the answer is something to do with the fact that bonobos live in stable groups, unlike these constantly varying groups of chimps that give rise to the power asymmetries where aggression can be easily carried out very safely. The reason that bonobos live in more stable groups is because they have access to different kinds of foods from the chimps. And the specific foods that appear to be really important are those that are also eaten by gorillas. Well, now guess what? There are no gorillas in the areas of Africa where bonobos live. They live in the areas where chimpanzees live. So chimps and gorillas compete over these certain foods, and because there are gorillas there eating them, then the chimps can't. So the gorillas are able to eat them, and by the way, that leads them to live in stable groups. The foods we're talking about are meadows of edible herbs on the forest floor. So in the bonobo areas, no gorillas to eat them. The bonobos do, in fact, eat them, and when they're eating them, they can stay together in stable groups just like the gorillas can. So we think that there is a deep ecological difference between these two species that's led to a difference in grouping patterns, that's led to a difference in the economics of aggression, such that aggression doesn't pay in the bonobo world. And they've ended up self-domesticating, a bit like ending up like a dog compared to a wolf.
So is it, I guess, resource abundance that leads to stability? I mean, is this herb pretty abundant where you don't have to really fight for it or take a risk
for it? That's right. Yeah, it's a kind of a local resource abundance. It's the way the food is distributed that enables bonobos to take this different evolutionary path. And it just shows how arbitrary it is whether or not a species ends up being more or less aggressive.
Okay. So let's move on to this, because I thought this is really interesting. It's about patriarchy, right? It's a hot topic amongst social scientists and feminists. And it's popularly thought that patriarchy is this complete social or cultural construct, and it's often unique to Western cultures. However, you highlight research in your book that not only from primatologists, but also from anthropologists, that patriarchy is much more ubiquitous than we formerly thought, and that there's likely a biological reason for it. Can you describe the theory of how patriarchy has a biological underpinning?
Yeah, I mean, this is one of these classic confusions when people are looking at sort of somewhat related questions and appearing to disagree when actually they don't really. In other words, sure, patriarchy is strongly cultural in the sense that there are lots of differences among different human societies. Some are much more patriarchal, some are much less so. And those differences are going to be due to culture, not to differences in genes or anything like that. But at the same time, if you look at humans compared to other species, then you find that we are sort of a particular characteristic form. And that is, we are a species in which overall there is a very consistent tendency for patriarchy in every society. So were there any true matriarchal societies among hunters and gatherers or anybody else? No. You don't find it at all. You find sort of people sometimes drifting in that direction. You find sometimes women's houses or women's being able to take important roles in communal decisions. But if there is ever a clash between what the men want to do and what the women want to do, then the authority always resides with the men. So in that sense, every single human society is patriarchal. And by the way, you know, this is not just some man saying this. I mean, if you take, there was a book edited by two strong feminists called Women, Culture, and Society in the 1980s, and it was endless chapters by women anthropologists, and everyone agreed. You know, there are no matriarchal societies. So this is not some fantasy of men. This is a very firm conclusion from an analysis of the political lives of people living in every different kind of society.
And so, I mean, what is, so we all see patriarchy not only in humans, but in chimps in a way. I mean, so why is it, because males, both in chimps and in humans, are physically stronger and that they have to do these raids to go and, you know, get more territory? I mean, is that the biological underpinning of patriarchy in both species?
I mean, it may well have played a role, but it clearly isn't enough. And here's why we can say that. The bonobos provide a fascinating counterpoint. Because in bonobos, the males are bigger than the females. And if it was just a matter of strength, then the bonobos would undoubtedly be able to dominate the females. But if there are conflicts between males and females in bonobos, the females routinely win. And you can talk about them being sort of co-dominant between the males and the females, or sometimes you can say that the females seem to be dominating the males, but you never say that males are dominating the females. So there is a case where the differences in strength are not enough to account for the differences in social behavior. And the missing piece is the motivation of individuals to get together with other members of their own gender or sex, in the case of bonobos and chimpanzees, and form alliances. And in chimpanzees and humans, you have this very strong motivation of men to form really effective alliances that fight alongside each other. And it's quite clear that that would have paid off in evolutionary time in the context of fighting against neighboring groups. And I think that a very reasonable interpretation of the evolutionary history of patriarchy is that it stems from that tendency. It stems from, essentially, war. So men now are able to use the alliances that they have come to so readily form in the context of war to dominate life within each society, whether it's modern day America or hunter gatherers living on the African plains. And by the way, you know, one should recognize that patriarchy in this sense of male dominance is cultural in this sense, that it depends on the relationships among men or among women at the level of communal discussion. But if you're talking about just a man and a woman alone in their house, then it's quite wrong to think about males always being dominant. I mean, in some marriages, a man might be dominant to a woman. In others, a woman might be dominant to a man. Mm-hmm. There is no consistency there. It's once you get to the social, cultural area that you get the consistency. But what is so striking, as you said, is that it occurs both in humans and in chimpanzees.
Fascinating. So here's a question. So you're at Harvard University, correct?
Yes.
So I think one of your colleagues, Steven Pinker, wrote The Better Nature, Angels of Ourselves, and he makes the argument that violence is decreasing in the world. So, I mean, if violence and aggression is an evolved trait in male humans, why is it that violence is going down? Can culture tame the beast, or is there something else that's going on that because we live in an environment that has resource abundance, we no longer have to be violent to gain an advantage in the world?
So the answer to that, I mean, there's this big question. You say, well, if it's an evolved tendency, then how come it's going down? The implication of the question is that if something has a biological component, then it's going to be fixed. But that's an inappropriate implication, and I'm glad you brought it up, because it's really important for people to recognize that just because there's an evolved tendency, that doesn't mean it's fixed. Mm-hmm. And yeah, Pinker did a wonderful job in showing that at everywhere you look, there is a tremendous evidence of a reduction in the actual frequency of death by violence or torture or slavery or all sorts of things that were far worse in the past in terms of violence. So what is happening? Well, one of your ideas was, have we become so well supplied with the resources that we don't need to fight? I don't think that's a very powerful explanation, because if you look in history, and if you look in animals, and if you think about it theoretically, you actually expect that animals, individuals, groups of humans that have the great ability to use resources to attack their neighbors will do so. There are many examples where, as you get more resources and have more power, then you use it. So merely more power for some groups is not so important. But however, if you say so everybody is doing better and so we're all able to put up more effective defenses, well, then that would seem much more reasonable. Hmm. I think Pinker drew attention to, I think he had six different forces that he reckoned were very important, and some of those were moral, you know, the spread of a different kind of morality towards people of neighboring groups. Can culture tame the beast? Absolutely. It clearly is doing so. To me, the really exciting area is the development of institutions that has been going on for several hundred years that intervene when there is war. I mean, you know, we're seeing it now. A tremendous number of ideas and organizations are being brought into play to try and control the violence that's going on in the Middle East. Well, 1,000 years ago, it would have just played itself out and people would have massacred each other without anyone intervening. So there's now a much greater effort at all levels to reduce violence wherever it appears.
Okay. So your book, the title of the book is Demonic Males, and I think some people who would read it or would get the idea that, you know, men are inherently flawed because they have this violent tendency and human culture is somewhat helplessly at the mercy of the male propensity towards violence. But are there reasons, you know, for optimism in your research, and what do you hope people take away from these insights in your book?
I think, you know, I'm generally a positivist who thinks that the more we understand, then the better we can take advantage of our understanding. And I do feel that the reasons for optimism, I think that one of the things that demonic males reminds us is that there are important psychological differences between men and women, and I think it's a real stimulus to help promote the notion of increasing political power for women. I think it's just great that countries like Rwanda and some of the Scandinavian countries have now got around 50% of the legislatures at the national level being composed of women. I think one can confidently expect that will tend to lead to less aggressive policies. Among men purely, I think that if we can understand that aggression is motivated by power difference, which is what much different kinds of research suggests, then we are reminded that it's really valuable to try and erode power differences, to make sure that we have balances of power at all sorts of different levels. Because the way natural selection and evolution work is that individuals don't want to take risks. And if we can reduce the cultural enjoyments for militarization, then if we can arrange society in such a way that there aren't huge imbalances of power, we can expect that we will live in a much nicer world.
Very interesting. Well, Dr. Wrangham, this has been a fascinating discussion. Thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure.
Well, thank you so much for the interview. It's wonderful to talk to you.
Our guest today was Dr. Richard Wrangham. He is a professor of biological anthropology at Harvard University and the co-author of the book Demonic Males, Apes and the Origins of Human Violence, and you can find that book on Amazon.com. Well, that wraps up another edition of the Art of Manliness podcast. For more manly tips and advice, make sure to check out the Art of Manliness website at artofmanliness.com. And if you enjoy the show and you're getting something out of it, I'd really appreciate if you'd go onto iTunes or Stitcher or whatever it is you use to listen to the podcast and give us a rating. That will really help us out. Doesn't matter what it is. If you think it's 5 stars, 5 stars. If you think it's 1 star, 1 star. That's okay. Be honest. And I'd really appreciate that. So until next time, this is Brett McKay telling you to stay manly.